Good morning, everyone. I'm Monica Rathi, and I head the business development at Mahindra Susten. As most of you would know, Mahindra Susten is into utility solar space. We have about 1.7 gigawatt of solar assets as of now. Other than the utility solar, we also are into distributed solar, where we do rooftops. And we are also a big O&M partner, so we don't just do O&M for our own plants, but we also provide these services for the third parties. Now, before I start this presentation, has anyone thought how much money a developer could lose if the PR number changes by 1%? So for example, if you are talking about 78% and that's the guaranteed PR, but what you actually get in the plant is about 77%. Any thoughts how much money on an yearly basis a developer would lose? Even at a tariff as low as 2.5 rupees. So I did some maths, and even at a 2.5 rupees tariff, it means a loss of about 80 to 85 lakhs a year for a 100 megawatt plant. And that's a pretty huge number, right? All your cash flows, all your IRR calculations goes for a toss if O&M is not done properly. This is what I want to start our session with, that O&M is very, very critical. O&M is something which is gonna last from, let's say if the plant came into operation within first 6 to 7 months, from that 6 to 7 months up till the end of life, which could be 25 to 30 years, right? There are three levers that any solar plant has to ensure that we get the IRRs that we talked about and worked out in the financial models. First one being, the plant has to be done in a completely robust manner. So robust design is the first foundation. Quality execution becomes the second big lever. If execution is not done properly, of course, you could have a lot of defects coming up, which would show up challenges during the O&M phase. And the last one being the efficient O&M. I'm not talking about the fourth piece, which is monitoring analytics, because that's the backbone of how we do the entire calculations. If I talk about operations and maintenance, let me take a minute to break that down into what do we really mean by operations and maintenance. Operations is all about how do we ensure that we get and maximize the performance and maximize the uptime of that plant. It could mean driving towards the global or the local maxima, and I will touch upon this concept later in the slides. Second one being about maintenance. Maintenance, there is a paradigm shift. It could be a condition-based maintenance, it could be predictive, it could be preventive. So we are talking about a proactive maintenance rather than talking about a reactive maintenance where you have a shutdown. And last piece, which is analytics. There are millions and millions of data that we get from the plant every single day, be it from the combiner box, be it from the inverter, the switchyard. How do we ensure that there is enough analytics which churns out these numbers and figures out what is the best and what is the best way to optimize this plant? Let me touch the first pillar, which is the maximization of plant uptime. Now, as I said earlier, 1% reduction in PR means a lot loss of revenue. PR is a combination of a lot of parameters, and as you would know, uptime is one of the biggest contributor there. We have been seeing plant uptime in the range of 99.5% and above, and uptime could then be subdivided into, or if I look at the downtime from that perspective, we could have shutdown maintenance, which of course means that yes, there is some defect that has happened because of which you have had shutdown, and this would mean complete loss of revenue, whether it is for a particular cluster or it could be for the complete plant. The preventive maintenance is usually done late in the evening or in the low generation hours, just so as to ensure that yes, you do a health check basically for the entire plant so that you are able to get the maximum generation later. And last one being predictive maintenance. This is where the future is. This is where you are looking at one cluster and comparing it with the performance of the other cluster and saying both the parameters are same, both the clusters are same, the inverters are same. So why is that this inverter is giving me a better efficiency compared to the other inverter, right? It is still, there is no maintenance required per se, right? It's just looking at that global maxima from a perspective of optimizing the entire plant. Getting to the root cause of, oh, maybe for this inverter, the temperature rise in this inverter is higher than the others. Then getting further down, is the temperature rise because of the inverter itself, or is there something happening at the combiner box level or at the module level because of which you are getting lower efficiencies? So that's what this predictive maintenance is all about. The second key pillar is maximizing the plant performance. Now, we talked about solar parks, and you would be surprised to know that even in a solar park, where you have multiple competitors having different plants, the performance of one plant is not exactly the same as the performance of the other plant. The irradiation is same, right? You are at the same location. More or less, the technology is same if they have been constructed in the same period, be it 1000 volt or 1500 volt system. But still, you see the performance differences between plants. The major difference is because of how do you go about increasing the performance of that plant by doing a proper maintenance and operation of that plant. When I talk about equipment benchmarking, we are not only talking about equipment benchmarking within the plant, but we are also talking about equipment benchmarking outside the plant. So you could look at that for our solar plant compared to other plants in the solar park, the performance is less. And then do a root cause analysis of why that is happening. A lot of this, of course, cannot happen manually. We would need SCADA, we would need cloud computing, we would need the IoT to be able to help us understand these performance differences. The last piece, as I said, predictive and conditional maintenance. It could mean, Mr. Reddy talked about doing an entire plant survey using drones, right? We could also look at localized surveys by doing a thermal imaging of the PV modules. It could be thermal imaging of the DP structures. We also have a PV lab, and it's a mobile PV lab, which could help you do EL testing and flash testing right there on the ground. Rather than waiting for us to send the modules back to the lab, this is something that you can manage at the site level itself. Now, we talked about operations and maintenance. What are the major challenges that an O&M provider has at site? It is not just the technology challenges. The challenges could be local issues. We have all heard about vandalisms and thefts. We have all heard about fires in the plant. For one of the plant, I still remember, the fire had come up just because of the fact that the security guard who was sitting there, he was feeling cold and he just wanted a little bit of warmth for himself. Now you can't really stop some of these challenges. What is really required in this scenario is experience. Experience of your O&M partner who knows and understands how to train the manpower who is at site and how to ensure that some of these local issues are handled in a proper manner. Be it a sarpanch walking into the plant and saying that, okay, I want such money, or I'm the module cleaning, the water that you're gonna be using for module cleaning would be at a higher cost compared to the cost that you were getting earlier. So how do you manage some of these challenges become very, very critical and imperative when you are doing operations and maintenance of the plant. Grid issues, of course. We, with additional solar plants coming in, I think we have all heard about storage. There would be challenges of frequency regulation. There would be challenges of forecasting. There would be challenges of the frequency not getting matched, because of which there would be load on the grid. So how do we ensure that even with all the grid variations and instability, the liaisoning that is required with the DISCOM at that point of time is done properly to enable your O&M plant to give you the PRs and to give you the generation numbers that you had taken in the financial models. The last piece, which is critical, and I think we all heard this, the major contributor to an O&M is the manpower cost. If you see this bucket, manpower, including the site and security, contributes to almost 60% of the total cost. So could there be technology which could be used to reduce this? we have at least an internal target of talking about manless solar power plants sometime in the future. And some of the technologies which would help us is doing a remote monitoring at our remote operation center, doing drone-based analysis of the entire plant, and having a cluster-based approach within the plant. So if you have multiple plants within Karnataka, there could be one person who is stationed at one of the locations who runs to any of these sites as and when required to do any shutdown maintenance. But other than that, we are looking at how do we make the solar plants completely manless. Now, this is a typical example of a 20 megawatt plant. We are looking at, I will not talk about each of these individual pieces, but we are looking at roughly about 7.8 million data points every day coming out of this plant. So remote monitoring and control becomes very, very critical, which is where a proper SCADA is what is the need of the hour. The traditional O&M, if you would see, was all about monitoring. The new age O&M, and I would refer this to the way medical industry has moved, right? Earlier we used to talk about if there's a disease, you come up with a solution. But today we have a lot of predictive health checkups. We have a lot of analysis of how your parameters have been fluctuating up and down to be able to give you a solution for the same, which is where your entire O&M approach itself is changing. In the new age, we are talking about control through the SCADA, we are talking about optimization through the SCADA, looking at the kind of parameters that we just saw. Mahindra Susten gets a little advantage here because we have our own in-house SCADA system, which is called Machine Pulse or Solar Pulse. Again, we have a portfolio of about 1.5 gigawatt here, both internal as well as third party. This is something that I just talked about in terms of the medical analysis. So we are moving away from descriptive to diagnostic to a prescriptive analysis, right? And this is how you will be able to optimize the entire solar plant by integrating the various parameters. Now let me take a sample case study of what could cause underperformance. And we are talking about underperformance of modules here. So I'm not sure if there are any manufacturers sitting here who would probably say that, okay, snail trail doesn't really have an impact on the performance of the plant. But we have at least seen some of these like micro cracks, snail trails, over a period of time do impact the performance of the modules. For thin film, we are even talking about hot spots and active area corrosions. Practically speaking, if I have to identify any of these faults, look at the cycle with which we will be able to identify. So we started with, let's say, this plant is commissioned in March 14. This is a typical example. By April 14 or May, you started realizing that the degradation is, or the performance is not at the level that you would have wanted it to be, right? But there is no way to pinpoint at it still. Somewhere around August, you start doing some UL testing to figure out the performance. Then that module where you had identified that, yes, there's a micro crack or this module is underperforming, you sent it to a UL lab, get it tested. You go back to the manufacturer, show him all the data. And by the time it is December or Feb, you actually are able to get that warranty claim. So we are talking about a cycle of almost 12 months to 14 months to be able to even predict that your module is not performing up to its level and to be able to get a warranty claim on that. What is going to be critical in future, where we are talking about 100 mega, I mean the plant size, the average plant size that we are looking at today is 100 megawatt. How do we reduce this cycle? One of the solution is having a PV mobile lab. This is one of its kind. It's a mobile lab which can go from one location to the other. It carries a EL tester, it carries a flash tester. The NABL accreditation is still ongoing, but once it is accredited, you don't need to wait for the modules to be sent back to the labs. You could do the entire testing right there on the ground and go to the module manufacturer saying that this was the degradation number that was promised and this is what I am getting. So this is how we will have to build. This is one of the labs that we have from Susten, but I think this is the kind of infrastructure that we need to build to be able to get the O&M optimizations as we would require in the future. Again, another example of a control center. This is the central command center that runs 18/7 at our Sustin office in Mumbai. The way this helps is, of course, we have experts sitting here in the remote center, so I don't need the same experts sitting at the site. They are able to do remote troubleshooting and then guide people at site that this is what might have gone wrong, why don't you change, or why don't you do these actions to be able to get the plant up and running. I'll just take a minute to talk about Sustin's capability here on this slide. Some of the services, as I said, we provide is having our own SCADA system, which is Solar Pulse. We do have in-house field testing teams, which are, you of course get the advantage of having the PV lab, as well as we help analyze a lot of developers when they're trying to buy or acquire already existing assets. What is the kind of performance that you are getting from this asset, and what are the different ways to optimize? So that is another service that we provide. We do have the drone with thermal camera to be able to do the kind of analysis that Mr. Reddy had just shown, and of course the power quality analyzers. So with this, I end.